Hi, I'm Bob Klacza. Welcome to this modems meeting featuring a presentation on hi-fi FM table radios. Here's the lineup. I've collected table radios for a while, starting in 1967 with a KLH Model 21, then moved on to an Advent 400, and recently acquired a Tivoli Model 1, a Model 3, an iSongbook, which is stereo, by the way, and a Sea Crane Gozo, little portable but plug-inable radio, AM and FM. Here's the lineup. This is what they look like. KLH is here. The Advent is here. The Tivoli 3 is actually a clock radio alarm clock. But Tivoli, having a good heritage in designers like Kloss, Henry Kloss, the iSongbook is this white thing in the middle with two speakers. That's the Model 1 Tivoli. And then finally, the little Gozo. Here's looking at it from the other direction. The KLH Model 21, again, purchased in 67. The radio was designed in 65 and was in production for about 5 years. And there's actually a cult following of this radio on eBay. If you have a good one and it looks relatively clean and crisp, this one has some wear on it from my mom turning it off and on forever. They still command a good premium over what you paid for it 50 some years ago. Next one, the Advent 400, actually has a speaker and a radio receiver that's monophonic. Now, most of these are monophonic, and that is really good because that way in stereo, you don't get all the stereo noise when you have a weak signal. The Tivoli Audio Henry Kloss Model 1, AM and FM. The other two were just FM only, by the way. The Clock Radio Model 3, the iSongbook, where you can take an iPhone and plug it in to the side of it. There's a little flap that comes down with a connector on it. And it's digitally tuning also. That's the other thing I might point out. The others are all analog tuning, you know, with a rotary dial and a vernier on it. The Gozo, the little portable. Again, AM and FM. This is the sales receipt from Alma's Hi-Fi Stereo, where I worked back in 1967 and purchased the radio for $53.30 plus 10% handling and carrying charges to Almas and $2.35 for the governor for the 4% sales tax. So it's a $61 radio and works perfectly today with no modifications, no changes, no repairs, no updates, no new capacitors. That's a really good testament to the quality of the work that was built into this, quality of the parts and labor.
Where's the employee discount?
This was dealer cost right here, the $53.30. I think this thing sold for like either $79.95 or $89.95, and that was a fair amount of money back in 1967. So this was an expensive table radio.
But it's still working.
But it still works.
Now,
the other interesting thing, and thank you, Mark, for stressing that, the Advent table radio, which is about 10 years newer, I had to replace every aluminum electrolytic in it because the capacity just started to disappear with age. The electrolyte dried up. Now, the test equipment I used to measure these things, I used an Earthworks Lab 1 microphone preamp and an Earthworks M30 microphone together as the calibrated microphone system, an audio control third octave analyzer, and all of these radios have an auxiliary input except for the KLH. So I had to get out the Sound Technology 1000A FM signal generator to be able to measure that radio with a pink noise input. Now, the funny thing is, a long time ago, you could just simply tune the FM band to the bottom or top of the dial, and it was just noise. But now, with the increasing infiltration of rectifiers, microwaves, and digital paraphernalia, the noise is not clean anymore and has a lot of sporadic, repetitive chirps in it and things like that. So you can't use that technique anymore like you could back in the 60s and 70s. So that's why I have the generator to, again, take the pink noise output right here from the audio control, run it into the input of the sound technology, and then broadcast a monophonic pink noise signal to the radio.
Just curious, is your generator connected directly to the antenna coil in the receiver?
Oh, no. It's simply just a wire of about 31 inches, going back to FM antennas that I did a couple of years ago. And that's just hanging out there, and the radio picks it up and goes from there. I'm not doing these in order because this is the order in which I shot the pictures of the spectrum analyzer. I started with the iBook because I thought that was kind of interesting. I had the pink noise running onto the input, and this is the main unit now. This is the big box. That's the frequency response.
It looks bad, but it's really pretty good.
Well, here's the catch. The iSongbook has a remote, has a stereo speaker that plugs into the main unit. Here's the frequency response of the plug-in speaker. Wait a minute, there's nothing below 2.5 kilohertz, but it's screaming away at 16 kilohertz and down. These are 3 dB per division, by the way.
Oh, they're three.
They're three, yeah.
Ooh.
Talk about shrill and peaky. This picture is 45 degrees off axis of the plug-in speaker. Now, wait a minute. That doesn't look all that bad. Okay. So, basically, what it's telling me is that this particular model, that stereo, wants you to have the speakers on each side of a screen and have 45 degrees between it and your ears. Voila. Now, if I took the main unit and went 45 degrees off axis from it, okay, it's not great, but at least it's not all peaky shrieky like it was before. So this is telling you point blank, you want the thing at 45 degrees from your ears. The Tivoli Model 3, from about 500 hertz to 12.5, isn't too awful bad, plus or minus 3 dB, but whoop. At 315 hertz, guess what? Sounds like a box. And when you listen to music, or better yet, the DLC Design LIT CD with the first track of David L. Clark speaking, you can hear it sounds like a box. Well, guess what? That's what that shows, and that's what it sounds like.
Let your cellos jump out.
The three.
The alarm clock,
yeah, which is again kind of an interesting unit, because the speaker on the alarm clock is actually on the top going directly upward, not on the front of it coming towards you, because the clock dial is where the Model 1 speaker is. And they put the clock dial there because it does you no good to be laying in bed and have the clock dial on the top of the cabinet. So they put the speaker there instead. So you can kind of sort of hear it. This is the Model 1. The Model 1 now has the speaker facing forward towards you. And it's actually not too bad, from like 100 hertz out to 20 kilohertz. But it's not smooth. And it's peaky.
Do you have a treble control?
No.
None of these have treble controls except for the Advent 400 and the KLH-21. The rest of them have no bass and treble controls or tone controls at all. except for the Gozo that has a little single knob kind of control. Now the Model 1, you, again, you go at the 45 degree angle, gee, it kind of smooths out a bit, but here's the box again.
Ooh.
Oh, I see someone reacted already. Gee, this isn't half bad. Who wants to guess which one this is?
$62.
That's the Gozo.
No.
They don't make anything like that now.
This is the Advent 400 that actually has a real live design speaker system that's fed from the radio receiver. So it's a real acoustic suspension, correctly designed, correctly tuned. Now, okay, fine, it starts to roll off at 100 hertz, but it's tailored.
Is it two-way?
No.
All of these are full-range drivers.
Are they sealed enclosures?
This is a sealed enclosure, for sure. From a frequency response standpoint, I could listen to that without too much trouble. Is it perfect? No. Here's the same speaker, 45 degrees off axis. Yeah, there's some roll off here. It's not as smooth, but okay, it's a single full range speaker.
None of them have a subwoofer output.
The iSongbook, I believe, does.
Oh, okay. It's Bluetooth, right?
No, that one is not Bluetooth. There's one subsequent that's Bluetooth.
There's one after that. Is it?
That's what I believe, yeah.
Which one was the KLH graph?
I did measure it. I believe this is the KLH here.
Did you use the FM generator for all of them?
No, I used the auxiliary input for all of them, except for the KLH, which didn't have an auxiliary input.
Did we run a graph of that?
That's what you're looking at.
That's what, so we got that answered.
It looks like the small box is something that none of them overcome.
Correct.
They have the one note or the one resonant fake bass type of thing going on. I would think that would sound really bad on AM.
Yeah. I think you could dampen that.
Basically, the two that stood out for a maximum dBs PL at a half a meter was the Advent 400 and the Model 3. Those got up to 100 dBs PL as measured with a Radio Shack sound level meter. The others, like the Model 1, got up to 98, which is pretty good. The iSongbook right speaker, the plug-in add-on, don't bother. The frequency responses, the Songbook was by far the worst. Shrieky, shrill, and no bass. The others weren't too bad, but like, for example, the Advent 400, 100 to 20K plus or minus 3 dB. It was down 10 dB at 72, and well, it's still up there at 20K. The KLH-21 did go from 100 to 11K, plus or minus 3 dB, except it had a 3 to 6 dB peak around 200 to 315 hertz. It was not smooth, as we saw in the picture. Now, at 45 degrees off axis, it's still 100 to 5K, 3 dB down, and 6K, 10 dB down, but that's because of the irregular pattern of directivity from the speaker, you know, from the cone angle and all that. Bottom line, if I had to choose one radio to listen to on a table radio application for the rest of my life, it'd be the Advent 400, and probably followed by the Gozo, because it actually was about 100 hertz to about 11 or 12 K, and its directivity was fairly well controlled. Any other questions?
What's the price of the Gozo?
It was $100. However, it is out of production. It's no longer made. You might be able to find one on eBay if you really want it. I just picked it up on a Lark one time when they were offering a sale. Picked it up, and it's been a great AM and FM receiver, and it does operate off of batteries too. So, you know, it's like when you're working out in the yard, digging or raking or something, works just fine. Other questions? Thank you very much.
You know, it's another area that's really expanding. It's not table radio, but I've been seeing all these portable worksite radios. By these great solid brand names like Milwaukee, DeWalt.
Yeah. Ryobi. And Bosch has got one.
Yeah, Bosch. They all have them. You know, they run off of.
They run off of their batteries too. Yeah.
Right. I worked at the Jefferson North Assembly Plant for 3 years. As a quality engineer. There were a number of those Milwaukee and Ryobi and all that boombox radios out there. The bigger and better the tool brand name was, the worse it sounded. Absolutely. The one that looked the toughest and cost the most sounded absolutely the worst. But that's a topic for a different discussion.
I stared at one some customer bought in and says, there's no freaking way I'm going to get into this thing. I can't even figure out. It had bars all the way around it.
Yeah,
like
it's made
generator.
To get dropped on.
Is it Bosch? I called it Bosch. Is there any way to fix these things? They looked at me. You really want to try to fix it? we don't have any schematics or parts. They don't have schematics at Bosch. Just literally, you can't ask them for a schematic on a passive crossover.
Because
and I'm a warranty
made,
center.
It's all made in China?
Plug in a new board.
Yeah, just buy a new board.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.